I didn't know what I was going to preach. When I left, and I didn't make any announcement about it over the radio, and I really didn't know what I was going to preach till last night at about 11 o'clock, and I believe the Lord wants to have me bring you a message on the sin of prayerlessness, the sin of prayerlessness. James chapter 4, and let's stand together and begin to read verse 1. James chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust that war in your members? You lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your lusts. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Do you think that the Scripture saith, in vain the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy, but he giveth more grace? Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Our Father, we pray the words of the Holy Spirit will find root in our hearts and lives. Lord, may we be doers of the word, not hearers only. Bless your people who have assembled in your name this morning. Bless the family. Supply the need. Lord, they have spiritual needs as well as emotional and physical and material needs. And we pray in this hour these needs will be met, because thou hast said that thou shalt supply all their need according to riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Lord, give us a warm spirit of fellowship here this morning and blessing, and draw us up close to thee and manifest yourself to us. And Lord, remove anything from this sermon or anything from the mind of this congregation, Lord, that would hinder thy Holy Spirit from having his complete way and his will and his sway and dominion over our lives. And we ask it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Now, in James chapter 4, verse 2, at the end of the verse, it says, you have not because you ask not. And I want to talk about that part of the scripture right there. You have not because you ask not. Now, I take for granted most of you people are saved people. And you know, unsaved people, for them, prayer is the last extremity. But for Christians, prayer is the first necessity. It's not the last extremity. The last thing you do about a thing before you finally give up is pray. That isn't right. The first thing you ought to do before you try anything is pray. See, prayer is the first necessity. It's not the last extremity. It isn't something that you pull out when you get in a tight spot and hope it'll work. It's something that you pull out before you get in a tight spot to get you through. Did you know the greatest job that a man ever had in lifetime, and it's a lifetime job, the greatest job you ever had in lifetime is to find God and get to know him and then have fellowship with him. That's the hardest thing any man ever had to do. It's a lifetime job. Well, you can get saved in half a minute. You can get saved before I say the next word. That's long enough. So you can be saved that quick. But getting to know the Lord and have fellowship with him, that's a lifetime job. The other day I was up there flying up in the air and just going by faith one step at a time. It's the one who ever got the planes. Boy, it was a trip, I'll tell you. I wonder sometime why I didn't go up there anymore after I get through with one of those things. And come back to Washington, boy, that place is a sight. And up there in that plane, I was flying along and looked down across those cloud banks and those storms and saw those old houses down in the Appalachians all covered with snow. And I've seen it many times. I've flown over those things so many times, I think if you dump me out in a parachute, I could find my way back home in a week without even having a guide, just over the same range of mountains. But I don't recall more than one time in the last 10 years when I began to think along a certain way. I got looking out there and seeing those houses down there, and you know, I was reminded of the fact that the Lord knows what's in every one of those houses, the 30,000 feet under that plane, and every conversation, every bedroom, and every living room, and every bootlegger, and every one of those stills out there in the mountains, and they got them all through there. And you know, the Lord sees all that and knows where all those blades of grass are and all that foliage and all those ants, and I'm up at 30,000 feet looking down that thing. You know, I'm limited. My goodness, I'm limited. How in the world can a human being sitting on a plane just contain box and skin and bone, you know? Like they ask a kid in school, they say, what is cowhide good for? And he said, to keep the cow together. And here I am, see, just boxing skin and bones to keep the bones together. And here I am sitting up here. How in the world can I have fellowship with a being that keeps track of all that? And then keeps track of you folks while I'm gone. And then keeps track of the congregation I'm getting to. And hasn't forgotten one fish off Oahu. And hasn't forgotten one Japanese over there by Fujiyama planting his rice. How in the world can I have fellowship with somebody like that? I know what the New Testament says. I can preach you a message on it. But did you know that's something? You think, how in the world can a human being have fellowship with a being like that? That's a job. That's a lifetime job. All right, now, first of all, about this business, you have not because you ask not, folks, when you don't pray. When you don't pray, when you have the sin of prayerlessness in your life, you know what you do? You show a contempt for God's Word. I mean, God's Word says, ask and you shall receive. You don't ask, you show contempt for it. One time, Isaiah was talking with Ahaz. And Isaiah said to Ahaz, he said, ask for a sign on the heavens above, the earth beneath. And Ahaz got real pious and said, I won't tempt the Lord. And Isaiah said, I never asked you to tempt him, I asked you to ask him. And Ahaz said, well, you're probably laying a trap for me. And Isaiah said, the Lord told me to ask you to ask him for a sign. And Ahaz said, well, that's all right, I don't need a sign, Jews look for a sign. And Isaiah said, all right, if you don't ask for a sign, you're just wearing God out, and God's going to give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bring forth the son and call his name Emmanuel, and so forth and so on. Ahaz wore the Lord out. He showed contempt for God's word because he wouldn't ask. Did you ever have a dog and throw a stick to him and try to get him to bring it back to you? You know, some dogs will pick up that stick and they'll bring it back to you about two times. And then the third time, they'll catch on to what's going on. And they figure you're just playing them for a sucker, and they'll just leave the thing there. Or they'll pick it up and carry it off 4 feet and drop it someplace else. Or they'll run around the yard with it so you can't catch them. And you know what the Lord does? The Lord says, come unto me, talk to me, have fellowship with me. And we won't do it. We won't do it. So you know what the Lord does? He drops some big old load on us just about break your back, and then we come back. You see? The Lord says, fetch it, and you won't fetch it. So the Lord put a load on you, and you bring it back. One time a man was bragging about a thoroughbred collie he had, and he just bragged about that thing till the fellow listening to him was bored to tears. And finally the fellow he was listening said, does that dog have any fleas? You know, I mean, he's such a fine dog, he couldn't have had fleas. He says, does that dog have fleas? And that old fellow owned that thoroughbred collie said, well, he said, he has just enough fleas to remind him that he's still a dog. And he said, oh, God will put just enough on you so it'll remind you you're still human. And you need prayer. And you need the Lord. You need to come back to him. It's strange how folks will worry about things and don't pray about them. They went to school one time and asked these kids, asked one kid, what's the biggest problem in your life? And he told them. And they said, do you pray? He said, yes, same with prayers every night. And they said, do you ever talk to God in prayer about that? And the kid hadn't. He said, you know, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, but he never talked about that. God will put a burden upon you to bring you back. And when you run off from God and don't come back and pray to him, you show contempt for his word. And we can all get in this situation. I remember an embarrassing thing I got into one time. There's a preacher up in Carolina named Oliver Green, and he's a good one. He's a good one. And I got in a big tent meeting he had one night, and I was down there in about the third row. And everybody knew I was there, and I was preaching all over town. And he got down there and he said, haven't you been a little bit careless, you know, about prayer? Haven't you been a little bit careless, you know? And he kept on coming down that line. And then he got to the invitation and he said, now, if you know that you've been careless about it and God has spoken to your heart, would you just raise your hand? And I had my head bowed in that seat, you know, and the Lord said, raise it. And I said, well, Lord, a lot of people here know me, you know. And he said, if you've been a little bit careless about it, now come on, haven't you been a little bit careless about it? And I raised my hand. And then that wasn't the worst of it. The worst of it, he got the invitation, and when we stood up, he said, now, you folks have raised your hands. He said, if you really meant business for God, he said, get out of your seat and come on down here. And the Lord said, go on. And I said, yeah, but Lord, and right behind me, there were four preachers that I knew sitting right behind me. And he said, now, if you really care about prayer and you want to make a thing right and you really mean business, get out of your seat and come on down. And I stood there and I said, but Lord, what if they see me? Lord, I don't care if they see you. He said, the invitation is, if you've been careless about it, want to make it right, come on now. Oh, I had a time of that thing. And down I went. Down I went. And I tell you, folks, if you don't learn to come back to the Lord and get on your knees once in a while, you know what you do? You show contempt for his orders. He says, fetch it, boy. Fetch it, boy. And you run off across the yard. Lord, put something on you, make you bring it back. You have not because you ask not. Now, he said, if you have not because you ask not, you ought to ask. He says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. You show disbelief in God's promise. See, you understand? It's not just that you despise his commandment to pray. It's that you show you don't really believe what he said when he made the promise. He said, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and shall be opened to you. Call to me. Ask me and call to me. I'll show you mighty things which you know not. You have not because you ask not. You show unbelief when you don't ask. There's a song that says, what a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to him in prayer. Oh, what joy we often forfeit, something about, what pain we often bear, all because we do not carry everything. Everything. Brother, everything to God in prayer. We show unbelief in the promises. You have not because you ask not. Bud Robinson, that old-time Nazarene preacher I told my class about this morning, he was a sight. When he was 59 years old, he got run over by a car, and he had the right foot turned clear around backwards in the socket, and a compound fracture here with a bone coming clean out through the arm, and a compound fracture over here, and cuts and bruises. And he went to the hospital, and they said, you're going to lose an arm, maybe a leg. And they all got praying for Bud. And the doctor finally said, well, I'll take the case. And he was an atheist and didn't want to take the case. And he'd hang old Bud's arm up in a sling like this and leave an open wound there. Then he'd come in and try to scrape gangrene out of that bone, no anesthesia. And Bud just lie there and just hurt and hurt and hurt. And he, whenever he got hurt, and he yelled, glory to God! You know, just got so bad he couldn't stand it. He'd say, how are you? You know, those holiness preachers. And he'd go out there, and the doctor went around the hospital and said, you know, he said, I've heard a lot of phony Christianity, but that fellow's got it. He got the real thing. And the arm got worse and finally got down to the place where in about 2 hours it would be decided whether or not he could clean the thing or not. And the day that happened, old Bud Robinson was hurting so bad he couldn't even shout. And I'll tell you, Nazarene hurting so bad he can't shout, he's hurting. And so he lay there with that arm up there and he just prayed. He prayed an hour. And that old doctor scraped away on that thing, and Bud said that doctor just had the sweat just streaming down his face and just worked away on that thing. And after about an hour, he said that doctor suddenly stopped and put down that scalpel and said, glory to God, we got it. And Bud said, you see there, if I couldn't do him on shouting, the Lord had him do it for me. And Bud was praying, claiming the promises. You have not because you ask not. I have three Bibles. And I get a real answer to prayer. I write it down on a sheet of paper. I got about 56 of them written down. I mean, big things. Things that meant an awful lot. And I have three Bibles. And they mean an awful lot to me. And my first Bible, I had it, I got all my notes in it, it was all complete. I was going out to an airport one time, I left it on the hood of an automobile in the rain. And I drove out to the airport, I'd forgotten, I was talking with somebody before I went, I laid it on the hood of the car, and then a rainstorm came up, and I drove out to the airport, and that book went off the hood of the car into a ditch somewhere in Jacksonville, and I got home, didn't have any Bible. And it just poured down cats and dogs when I left. And I prayed. And I prayed that day and prayed the next day. And boy, I'll tell you, man, I was miserable. You get 10 years of notes and all that information in one book and then lose it. Boy, you're miserable. And about 4 days later, in came that Bible. Some woman in Jacksonville had found the thing and seen the address in it, mailed it in. Just dry as a bone. Just dry as a bone. There wasn't a page in it, even been wet. I've got it wetter than that with sweaty hands. And I remember another time I had a Bible. I got all my notes in it. And it was about 15 years' work. When I got about 15 years' work in that Bible, it was left in a car, parked down here in a lonely stretch of highway. And I went down there off apart from everybody else and by myself, took a dip down there. And when I came back, that car had been broken into and the valise was gone with the offering in it for the meeting and the Bible. And I cared nothing about the offering, but the Bible was in there. And you look up the road, nothing up that way. You look down the road, nothing down that way. How are you going to start? And so I reported the thing, highway patrol, and they didn't know anything. And I went home and prayed. And I prayed all that day, prayed all the next day. And at the end of 2 days, a phone call came in Panama City, and the highway patrolman said, we got your Bible down here. He said, the money's gone out of the police. Well, I said, well, I don't care about that. You got the Bible? He said, I got the Bible. I drove one down to Panama City, and there were two boys that broke into that car. One was a Catholic boy, and one was a Church of God boy, and they were from Middletown, Ohio. And they broke in that thing and got a hold of that valise with the Bible and the money in it, and they took the money in it. One kid wouldn't throw the Bible out to get rid of the evidence, another kid wouldn't let him. And they kept the Bible, so I got the Bible back. And after I got about 17 years of notes in that Bible, which was this one here, when I got about 17 years of notes in it, I took off my plane in Canton, Ohio, and the wing flaps froze. He couldn't land at Atlanta, so I missed connections there. He tried to land at Tampa, and the fog came in. I missed connections there. So went down to Miami. He landed at Miami, missed two connections, overshot the target 650 miles, got off at Miami, had to come back to Tampa, come back to Pensacola, got off Pensacola, no bag, Bible gone. I came back here, I had to preach to you folks, I'll never forget it, that next week. And I went back over there and went through my records, all my notes gone, see, all my sermons, all my chalk talks, everything gone. 300 sermons and 200 chalk talks, all illustrations, just gone. I had notes in the other Bibles, but didn't have the sermons and chalk talks in them. And you talk about sick. Man, I phone Canton long distance, nothing. Atlanta, long distance, nothing. Tampa, long distance, nothing. Miami, long distance, nothing. I said it got shuttled off Atlanta. Phone Kansas City, nothing. Phone Dallas, nothing. I phoned New Orleans, nothing. I phoned Los Angeles, nothing. I said it went back the other way. I phoned New York, nothing. I phoned back to Canton, nothing. I phoned back Atlanta, nothing. I mean, $37 worth of calls in about one afternoon. And sat down there, must have been 4 hours over in that office trying to remember, memorize, trying to remember, trying to get all that stuff back on 500 messages. You talk about sick, and you talk about praying. Man, I was praying. And about 4 days later, a phone call in came down here at the railroad depot. He said, you lose a suitcase? I said, yeah. He said, well, what's in it? I said, a Bible and four German records. And he said, we got it. And I went on down there to the railroad depot, and there was that Bible sitting there. It came in by a train from Boston, Massachusetts. Now, you tell me how that works, and I'll be a wiser man than I am now. It came in Railway Express from Boston, Massachusetts. Now, listen, prayer is what God wants. He wants you to believe the promise. He wants you to claim the promises. And listen, when you don't pray, you refuse fellowship with God. You refuse fellowship with God. The Lord wants to have you have fellowship with Him. Now, when you read the Bible, the Lord talks to you. But it's a one-way conversation. And when you pray, you talk to Him. And a Christian ought to have fellowship with the Lord. The hardest thing you ever had to do in your life is get to know God and have fellowship with Him. Why, old Billy Sunday walked so close to God that you couldn't tell when he was talking to God when he's talking with you. I heard old Bob Jones Sr. say that often when they go to a meeting together, they'd walk out to the tent, and Billy Sunday would be saying, now, Lord, bless Brother Bob and give him a good message to preach out of the bunch tonight, and just take care of him, and Bob, do a good job, don't compromise, and Lord, take care of him, and fill him with the Spirit, I'm going to preach tonight, I don't want to let him down, and Bob, I won't let you down, you know. And he said, he just walk along there, you couldn't tell when he's talking to you, when he's talking to the Lord. Billy Bray was that way. Billy Bray was a Welsh evangelist. He was a mess. He was a mess. He'd go along and he said, every time one foot goes up, it says glory. And every time the other foot goes up, it says glory. And when his wife died, you know, they found him dancing around the room on the sofa and all over the chairs and everything. And he was saying, glory to God, glory to God. He said, Betsy's gone home to be with the angels, you know. And he wasn't glad to get rid of her. I don't mean that. I mean, he was happy because she was home in heaven. And old Billy Bray, he said one night he was walking down a railroad bridge. And there were some fellows side full of joke on him, some mean fellows, and they got off way off under the bridge. And when Billy was walking along there saying, glory, glory, going down that bridge at night, one of those boys, a loud boy, said, Billy Bray? And he said, yes, praise God, and took a couple more steps, and one of them said, this is the devil. This is the devil. And they said, I'm right over here under this bridge. And old Billy said, well, glory to God to know you're that far away. Praise the Lord. And well, you know. And he had communion with the Lord. And folks, when you don't pray, you get out of communion, you get out of fellowship. The sin of prayerlessness is the sin of not wanting fellowship with God. You have not because you ask not. You have not because you ask not, and when you ask not, you hinder the work of the Holy Spirit. You hinder the work of the Holy Spirit. I get in conviction about myself sometime about these students. I'll take all the names and put them on a list and pray over them every day. And by the grace of God, I'm going to, but I haven't. I sometimes wonder what happened if I put all your names on a list. Just get a roster of the church, roll, and pray for every one of you every day. I don't, but I should. I mean, maybe why the Holy Spirit doesn't do more than he does around here, folks, maybe we don't pray enough. You can hinder the work. We need more prayer. We can't do it. I can't do it. It's going to take the Lord to do it. I think sometimes folks just trust my knowledge, you know, or trust my talent. They'll say, well, he can always get a crowd. Well, you always get a crowd, but I tell you, you can't do what God wants done unless God does it. Has to be prayer. Hinder the work of the Holy Spirit if you don't pray. Paul said one time, he said, I've got so much wood to cut, I just haven't got time to sharpen this axe. See how foolish that is? See, man, I've got so much work to do, I don't have time to pray. That's when you ought to pray. One time I had a meeting in Statesboro, Georgia, with a fellow named Bob Schatz, and he was a sight in this world. He had a little old church in Georgia, and he preached against Santa Claus one day over a little old radio station, a little town in Georgia. And boy, I tell you, if you're in a town with about 3,000 people and you hit Santa Claus, man, you had it. And he got on there, he had 64 telephone calls on three different lines in about an hour, and 8 businessmen canceled the contracts with the station, you know, because Santa Claus is, you know, that's money. And I had a meeting down there with old Bob Schatz and got down there, and it was a kind of a draggy meeting, and folks in the church were still upset about Santa Claus. And one afternoon I was being there in his room, and he said, Brother Pete, he said, why don't you take a 22 out this afternoon and see if you can find you some squirrels? And I said, oh, man, I'd like that. I'd enjoy that. Where are they at? And he showed me about where they'd be. And I got the 22, and the Lord said, don't you think you better pray this afternoon? And I said, well, Lord, I prayed yesterday and the day before, and I need a little relaxation, get out and move around a little while. And the Lord said, well, that's right, but today I think you better spend some time in prayer. I said, well, I have time when I get back, you know. And so I took the 22, went out in the field. And I'll tell you, brother, you talk about a mess. I hope I never live to see another afternoon like that. Everything went wrong. I got out in the field, went across this field. I didn't find the squirrels. And I came back with that 22 rifle and started out across that field and a bunch of bulls at the end of that field. And I got about halfway out in the middle of that field, and one of those old bulls just lowered his head, and he came down that row. I just coming at like an express train. And I waited till he got about 30 feet in front of me and took that 22 and fired it right at his feet. And he went off about 4 or 5 rows. And I didn't know laws then about what happened if you ever kill one of them things, but he wasn't going to kill me, I'll tell you. I fired at that thing, and he got out of the way, and I quickened my pace a little bit and got to the fence. And that fence was a 5-foot fence with 3 strings of barbed wire over the top. And that wasn't anything to clear. I cleared him like that, just, you know, one step, one leap over. But that day wasn't my day, brother. And I got up to that fence, and about the time I got to that fence, that bull came at me again. And I shot at him again and got up on top of that fence and went over that fence. And out of that fence, I'm one of those barbs, just caught that pant leg in the inside and just like that. And scratched the leg. My face came down across the fence. Another one went whoosh, like that coming down. I couldn't get off the thing on the other side. The other one went whoosh, like that. And man, when I lived on the other side of that fence, I had torn pants and torn shirt and blood all over me. And I said, I was saved. I was mad enough to cuss. I was just sitting there. I got, you know, that blood running down me. And I said, well, what a fool thing. Anybody could clear a fence like that, you know. And the Lord said, you should have been praying. Should have been praying. Folks, did you know that this church doesn't pray enough? Doesn't pray enough. Need prayer. You can hear the work of the Holy Spirit if you don't pray. We ought to pray more than we do. Ought to have more folks here in prayer meeting tonight. You know what we ought to have here one night, one Wednesday night? One Wednesday night we ought to have a men's meeting here where every man in this church be required to be here Wednesday night. Required, brother. I mean, no grace at all, brother. Just flat law. And required to be here. And all you men, just meet one time, just all pray together for a couple of hours. Need it. In the work of the Holy Spirit. You have not because you ask not. Folks, if I'm going to present Jesus Christ to a congregation every Sunday and present him out there to the world, and you're going to do it, it's going to take prayer. I paint a picture of Christ on the cross, the three crosses, and I have a red crayon. Come down there and draw that red crayon coming down his side, dripping off at his feet, and the bottom of that board's about here. And you know, I can stand above that thing this way, and I can draw down like this, but your line with the chalk, you know, runs out straight. You can't get it like you want standing up. So when I get down the bottom of his feet, you know, I usually kneel and take that red crayon and finish the blood coming down by his feet. You see, because if I'm going to really present Christ crucified, I've got to kneel. I said, if I'm going to really present Jesus Christ crucified, I've got to kneel. And you do too. He said, you have not because you ask not. Now, in this sin of prayerlessness here, you can invite spiritual disaster if you don't pray. It isn't just that you don't get what you want all the time. It's you can have a spiritual disaster if you don't. Now, that afternoon, I didn't have a spiritual disaster. I had a physical one. But you can have a spiritual disaster. You can have a spiritual shipwreck if you don't pray. I can't tell you folks how much your prayers for me mean the last 5 or 6 years. I mean, Lord got me through many a tight place in the last 6 years just because you folks have been praying for me. And I know it. And I hear you praying, and I appreciate your prayers. And many times, it's just your prayers got me through. And not everybody prays for a preacher like that. I'm glad the Lord put a burden on you about it. I hope he keeps it on you. It's a blessing to me. A fellow came to a preacher one time, and he said, preacher, he said, I've going to unload. He said, I've had this stuff stored up for a long time now, and I'm going to unload. And the preacher said, all right, brother, let's kneel and have prayer, and you pray for me and ask God to give me the grace to take it in the right spirit. And that broke the thing up, you know, because he never did pray for the fellow. And folks ought to pray for their preachers and pastors and evangelists. You ought to pray for each other. You ought to pray for yourself. I wonder if David, I bet old David probably could have been saved from adultery that afternoon in 2 Samuel chapter 11, walking that housetop, if he'd been praying. The Bible said he was looking, but he wasn't praying. I bet old Simon Peter, I bet he could have been saved from cussing that evening out there by the fire if he'd been praying. He was just warming, see? He's just warming himself by the fire, and if he'd been praying, he probably could have saved himself from a spiritual shipwreck. You can have a spiritual disaster. You young people I'm talking to right now, you know what you need to do? You need to take the Lord into your confidence. Now, do you know what I mean by that? I mean, when you go back in your bedroom at night and pray, you don't get down there and say, now, Father, I come to thee in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, pleading you the merits of his shed blood for my sins, and acknowledge that I am a sinner and in need of mercy and grace. And, Lord, I come to that this time. That isn't taking into your confidence. Now, what you want to do is go back in there and just out with it, brother, out with it. I mean, just plain four-letter words, just lay them out on the table. Some folks think that's so irreverent and so unsanctimonious, but, you know, God wants fellowship with you. Boy, it'd be a lot better to talk those things over with him and talk them over with the psychiatrist. Talk them over. Go back there and say, now, Lord, I did this and that, and this and that was wrong. This was that wrong. I couldn't help it because of this, you know, lie a little bit about it. And the Lord will say, well, that's because of this and this. And you'll say, well, that's right, but I really tried my best I can, you know, and try to beat your way around it. And I'll talk with him a while. And he'll say, well, you haven't really tried. You've done this. You say, well, Lord, I can't do that, you know, and I'll buy some more. And then, you know, by the time you stay there about 15 or 20 minutes, you'll be a different person. That's right. Lord wants to have you have fellowship with him. He don't want to have you come back there and get him into some big religious meeting that you learned about in church. Talk plain. Talk plain. And if you don't, you'll have a spiritual disaster. All right, the last thing I want to say about this text, you have not because you ask not, is this sin of prayerlessness can lead to the destruction of souls. A lady said one time to a preacher, she said, I've just talked to my husband about God and talked to him about God, can't do a thing with him. And he said, well, if you spend more time talking to God about your husband than you talk to your husband about God, maybe you get some results. And that isn't always the truth, but that's the truth a good many times. I believe that prayerlessness is responsible for the destruction of souls. One time a man in a factory was talking with a bunch of fellows, and he was an elderly man. He'd been in two or three churches and 5 or 6 business meetings, and he wasn't saved, but he knew church people, and he was talking about the hypocrites in the church. And that conversation got pretty rough, and there was a new convert there, and he finally turned to this fellow and he said, well, I think you're exaggerating it. He said, I don't believe there are hypocrites in the church like that. What kind are you talking about? And everybody began to fluster up and jump on him, and the old man said, now just hold the phone. He said, let me handle it. And he said, that young fellow, he said, you saved? And the kid said, yes. He said, you're going to go to heaven when you die? The kid said, yes. He said, you believe unsaved people go to hell? He said, yes. He said, you believe that I'm unsaved? And that young kid turned kind of red in the face and said, well, yeah, I believe you are. And he said, you believe I'm going to hell? And the young fellow got redder in the face and said, well, he said, yeah, you are. And he's true to the word. And the old fellow said, do you believe in prayer? He said, yeah, I believe in prayer. And the old man said, how much time you spent praying for me today? And that kid just had it, you know. He couldn't lie. He said, I haven't. And he said, that's the kind of hypocrite I'm talking about. Do you pray for unsaved people? Really pray for them? God will list the names. I don't say God's going to save them. I can think of folks I've prayed for 17 years that never did get saved. And I can think of some I prayed for 4 years that did get saved. And I can think of some I prayed for 10 years and they got saved. And I got news the other day of a fellow I've been praying for almost 16 years that just got saved. You pray for them? I read in the papers about famous people dying and getting killed, and I wondered, anybody ever pray for them? You know, you just read about those things. It says Clark Gable died, you know. And most people don't know that Clark Gable was witness to. I knew a fella in Mobile that got to his dressing room in Hollywood and went in and started to deal with it and got thrown out bodily, clean out of the dressing room. But in his concern, he went after him. I bet most of you folks don't know that Elizabeth Taylor had a chance in a hotel, in the King Edward Hotel in Toronto, Canada, where Burton and Elizabeth Taylor and some of her drunken friends were having a little a rehearsal in Hamlet. They were sitting down in a room there reading parts, and Liz comes in and says, well, give me a part to read. They said, the parts are all taken. And she said, if you don't give me a part, I'm going down the hall and read the Bible. And everybody, some old drunk, said, where's the Testament? And she said, well, there are a bunch of ladies down in room 951 when I went by asked me to come in and read the Bible with them. And they all got laughed, but one of them said, you know, let's all go down and read the Bible. One of them said, yeah, boy, we need it. And they started out the door, and pretty soon one of them said, well, he said, let's have one more drink. So they had one more drink, and they didn't go down to read the Bible. I wanted those ladies in that room praying for that woman. Last week, a fellow got killed in England. His name was Donald Campbell. And Donald Campbell was the son of Sir Malcolm Campbell. And Sir Malcolm Campbell, he had a race car, I remember, called, well, it was Barney Oldfield and his Golden Submarine was the name of one of those cars. And then Malcolm Campbell had a racer he used out in the Salt Lake Flats, and he got up to something like 200 miles an hour. That's slow now, you know, but 40 years ago, that was really moving. And he had a boy named Donald Campbell, and last week, Donald got killed. And I wondered, anybody ever pray for Donald? I mean, Donald had a $4 million hydroplane, a motorboat. Not a motor, it's a hydroplane. And old Donald Campbell, he went across that water trying to go 300 miles an hour, and Donald Campbell went up that runway at 297 and came back at 303, and if he'd have held it, he'd average 300 miles an hour on water, and he never made it. You know what Donald Campbell did before he died? Donald Campbell was a modern 20th century man. He had all the benefits of modern science. He was up to date with plenty of research and a college education and plenty of money and all the insides and outsides of gears and workings and jet propulsion and all that. Very educated fella, smart fella, up to date fella. You know what he did before he died? The night before he died, he got up in his hotel room and he got playing solitaire. And he turned over the ace of spades and the queen of spades. And he said, he's an Englishman, and he said, I say, so that's what Mary, Queen of Scots, drew the night before she was killed. And he said, I guess somebody in the family is going to get the jolly old axe. I hope it won't be me. Before he was killed. Reading the cards. 20th century. College education. Ace of spades. Queen of spades. And then the morning he got up to drive his racer, he got him a little Polynesian statue. You've seen him out in Tahiti. And he had this little Polynesian statue, and he rubbed the stomach on that statue for good luck. Before he went down and got him this $4 million 20th century jet-propelled hydroplane, rubbed the statue on the stomach. And then he got out in the car, and in the boat. When he got in that boat, he took in his lucky teddy bear with him. He had a teddy bear called Mr. Whoppet. And he took this lucky teddy bear and put this teddy bear in the boat with him and then started out. Never prayed. Father got to go 300 miles an hour, never even bowed his head and said, Lord, you just take care of me and get me back safely for Jesus' sake. Not one time fellow had more brains than anybody in this congregation, probably. And got his little teddy bear with him. And then he got in that thing and started off down across that water. He went down there at 297, hit that turn, came around that turn at about 100 and started back. And he got that thing up to 303. And about the time he got the thing up to 303, he said, it's shaking. It's shaking, they heard him say over the microphone. It's shaking. And before he could say another thing, that old thing turned over the nose this way and then skipped up this way, went up in the air. And I saw a picture of that thing when it started down. And that old hydroplane was 50 feet above that water, hidden for the water like that, and the speed in that thing was 300 miles an hour. That bird was 50 feet in the air like that, and 300 miles an hour. When that thing came down that water, it just went all to pieces, and they found that lake he was on was 142 feet deep. And the divers found pieces of the boat down there 142 feet deep, and they never found one piece of his body. They haven't found his body yet. They've been going there a week for it, a week, and they haven't found his body yet. I wouldn't have been about it if it prayed for that fella. When you folks watch television, you see the pro stars and Super Sunday, you pray for them. They go slam to the line there, sweeping around the end. You ever say, Lord, save? Yes, that's what's silly. It's not silly. It's not silly. He says, I would that prayers be prayed for all men everywhere. 1 Timothy chapter 2. Folks, prayerlessness can destroy souls. I dare say there have been people in this congregation that have come here Sunday to hear me preach, and Sunday night to hear me preach, that would have gotten saved if we'd just been a little bit more diligent about prayer. One time, R.G. Lee went to see a lady dying in the hospital, and you know what she'd say to him? She'd say, oh, I've heard you preach a lot of times. He'd say something, she'd say, oh, I've heard you preach a lot of times. He tried to lead her to Christ, and she'd say, I've heard you preach many times, but she wasn't saved. She wasn't saved. I wonder if anybody's praying for her. Let's bow our heads for a season of prayer, folks. Now let's all bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's have a little season of prayer right here before we leave the building this morning. Now I want you to pray for me, and I want you to pray for your deacons, your Sunday school teachers, superintendents, folks in positions of leadership. I want you to pray for these young men that come down here. They're beset with temptation every side. They're alone. Some came from families where they didn't have much love from mom and daddy, and they need love, they need fellowship, they don't have it. I want you to pray for them. Now really pray, people, really pray a while. I want you to pray. Now, I want you to pray for me. Ask the Lord to give me the strength I need now in this coming year to handle all this load the Lord has called me to handle. Ask Him to hold me up. Our Father, I'm thankful this morning for all these people that prayed for me, and I've heard them pray in the prayer rooms and in the homes, and I'm thankful for them. And Lord, I don't remember all of them all the time. And I pray you might help me be more diligent about this matter and hold them up before your throne daily. And Lord, I do remember some of them. It's a blessing to bring their name before thee and see you bless them and see you prosper them and see you take care of them and provide the need. Lord, help us to believe. Lord, help us not to get the idea if all our prayers aren't answered that it's just hopeless and useless. Father, save us from getting bitter and getting discouraged and wanting the whole hog and the cake, too. We don't need it. We need spiritual blessings, Father. You've taken care of us. You've provided. We have our need met. Lord, it may not have been met the way we want it to be met, but it's taken care of. And, Father, burden your people to pray now. And we pray for the unsaved here this morning. If there's anybody here that's never been born again, we pray you might save them. We pray for our folks in the hospital that you'll be real to them, strengthen them, get them out soon, heal them, provide the financial need while they're there. And Lord, we pray you'll give us a real spirit of prayer in the service tonight. Maybe see souls saved, men and women walk these aisles for Jesus Christ. And Lord, refresh us now and revive us and forgive us, Lord, for slacking up on prayer. And Lord, I don't guess there's anybody in this building that doesn't need forgiveness for that. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I want you to continue in prayer, people. Now let's pray God to give us a real year this year. Let's go right on and ask the Lord to save somebody in every service. Every service. Ask the Lord to get Brother Roloff in here or some other speaker that we can get a blessing from that will minister to us that we need, that has a message that God wants us to have. Lord, draw your people close in love together. And help them enjoy prayer together. Lord, the little selfish, carnal motives and things that are in our midst, take them out and remove them. The ulterior motive and the subversive desire to make a profit or make merchandise of God's people in any way, shape, or form, take it out, Father. Take it out. Take it out. Lord, take it out. Help us to love each other, be sincere, warm-hearted. Draw your people together, Father. Now, while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, before we leave this building this morning, how many of you folks should raise your hand right now and say, Brother Ruckman, I don't pray like I should, but I know I'm saved. I know I'm God's child. I believe in prayer. I know I'm saved. And I want to pray more than I do. Would you raise your hand? Would you hold your hand? All right. Your hands down. Is there somebody here this morning who could raise your hand and say, Brother Ruffman, I'm not a child of God. I don't believe I've ever really been saved.